you sat on your hands, you couldn't talk because your ability to speak seemed intimately connected to moving. So I'd have you sit on your hands and I could actually make a grocery list in my head for 35 seconds until you started talking again. And I'm like, is that really real? She goes, yeah, that's really real. She's like, you could always talk the ears off a donkey. And I'm like, well, there's no shortage of horses' asses around here these days to use that skill on. So 50 years into my little life, I found my lane. But yeah, I tend to be a caged lion. If you glue me to a podium, I'm just so unhappy. And so is the audience, because I'm like, I need to move. A little hyperactive, as it were. You want to start?
Whenever you'd like. I know there's still a lot of people making their way here.
Oh, okay. We can start. I'm going to just chit-chat for the first part, so they'll... Perfect. There's good stuff later. They won't miss much.
All right, everyone. Good morning. And a couple quick things first, especially for those of you that are here. They have DVDs of every talk, every workshop, every lecture. This is going to be so freaking amazing. I want everyone to get one of these DVDs of Leigh and pass it to somebody. Pass it forward to somebody that needs to know about this information and gift it onward. Plus, she's going to have so many amazing stories that we're all going to want to hear it again to get it in deeper. So on that note, let's all take one big, deep, yummy breath. And let's all feel the gratitude for Leigh Dundas.
Thank you so much, Maura.
Hold on, wait a second. Leigh is a freaking rock star, you all. In terms of an intro, she is a freedom fighter extraordinaire. She is a lawyer that is out here for our human rights. She's in the schools. She's going across the country. She's at rallies. As a matter of fact, she's usually got 400 or 500 people in the audience. Do you know how blessed we are to have you? Yes. There's thousands. And she's here for us. And it's such a gift, such an honor to have you. I also can say on a personal note that Leigh is one of the kindest, most caring people. She helped me out on a personal level with a ride the other night and was just a yes. So she stands up for people, for each of us, when she barely notices us or even has met us, not notices, but knows us. She's the real deal. With the hugest heart, the most passion. I think of you as a dragon. She's like this dragon goddess that's out there ready to take freedom home for all of us. I'm not going to tell you the story she told me. Hopefully you'll tell the one that
Probably.
You told me. Yeah. It rocked my world and gave me... She was already way up here in terms of how I'm impressed by her. And she shot it into the stratosphere because she is living this. And inspires us all how we can live this. And for everyone that's watching these DVDs, pass them forward. You all go to her booth. She's got these books, and we can share these forward. Just Stand Up, My Fight for Freedom, From the Brothers of Asia to the Streets of America. Let's support Leigh Dundas. And right now, let's give some awesome love, gratitude, and thank you to Leigh Dundas.
Thank you.
We love you.
Thank you, Maura. That was such a sweet intro.
You rock. Thank you for all your powerful work.
It is an honor to be here. I don't much care for football, so y'all saved me from having to watch something I don't usually watch. So thanks for coming out to see me, since I know some of you guys actually do like football. Again, for those of you who've never heard my name before, my mother gave me extra letters. It's Leigh Dundas, but it's spelled with 5 letters, L-E-I-G-H. I am a human rights attorney. I did not think I was going to be a human rights attorney. If you had told me a few years ago, or even as a child, that my crowning achievement after getting into Yale Law School was going to be standing on the brick planter bed in front of County Hall screaming at blue state tyrants, I would have thought you were smoking crack. But, you know, we make plans and God laughs, right? Stranger things have happened. So, what was I going to say first? Oh, I have a new website, leighdundas.com. And you can find my book there. I'm launching a podcast later this month, so you can go to the podcast page, sign up there. My 501c3 through which I fund my efforts is called freedomfighternation.org. For that is what we are, is it not? A nation of freedom fighters. Always have been, always will be. freedomfighternation.org. And I didn't always... Oh, here's the book, by the way. But, and I didn't know that General Flynn was going to be so sweet. He called it a tour de force penned by a modern-day Joan of Arc. And I thought he was being overly lavish with the praise, because we're buddies, we share stages all the time. And then his commanding officer bought it at the Miami Trump Doral Hotel and said it was the best thing he'd ever read, and the last chapter alone was worth its weight in gold. So, and then I gave it to my daughter, who's 18, and you know how that rolls, like they're not fans of their parents. And I said, you know, baby, thanks so much for letting mama go fight for freedom the last 3 years while you were in high school and I was never home. I gave you some love and the acknowledgments in the back. Just take a look at what mommy wrote. So she comes out of the nail appointment and she's like, I go, so what'd you think? And she goes, I didn't read the acknowledgments. I'll get to that later. I just started at chapter one. Mom, did you know you're funny? I did raise you. She's like, no, like really funny. I'm like, is this an insult or like praise? I'm not sure. She's like, it was so funny that the manicurist had me set it down because I was laughing so hard she couldn't paint my nails. So it's kind of like Irma Bombeck, you know, goes to the Thailand brothels. I talk a lot about the human trafficking fight in there. I didn't want it to be a treatise. There's a lot of lawyers and doctors doing great work. Mikovits, Bobby Kennedy, Ed Dowd. I wanted this to be curl up in your bathtub, read it with, you know, one eye open. You don't need your whole brain to understand it. So I wrote like I talk, and hopefully you'll enjoy it. If you don't have a copy, I'll sign one for you at the end. I'm the last booth on the left on your or on the right on your way to the bathroom. This was not, if you had asked me years ago, what do you think you're going to be doing in 2020? That was not what I thought I'd be doing, standing outside of a court with a Walmart bullhorn in my hand. I actually didn't even really want to be a lawyer. I wanted to be a dolphin trainer or a concert pianist. But I ended up going to college at 14, and 3 years later when I graduated, SeaWorld wasn't hiring, and my mother very astutely said, you know, you're kind of good at arguing. Might want to think about law school. You suck at math, but maybe law school. So I applied to Yale. I applied to Bolt. They were Berkeley's law school. I think they changed their name now. They were number two and number one in the nation. Yale was number one that year. Harvard was number three, and I boycotted them because I thought they were racist and sexist in their hiring policies. Because I was a little bit liberal then, you'll have to forgive me. And I also applied to U of Chicago, or U of Hawaii and U of Colorado, because I thought, well, heck, if the Ivy Leagues don't like a Doogie Howser applicant, at least I can surf and ski my way through law school, right? But I got in everywhere. They weren't scared off by my age. And 3 years later, I was launched on the unsuspecting legal population at the ripe old age of 21 as a fully fledged practicing attorney. I passed the state bar here in California the same year I could actually legally enter a bar without a fake ID, which was very handy because then I could celebrate my win without committing a crime. So I went off to a big old firm. They call them a white shoe law firm. I think that's because, I don't know, back in the day people wore white after certain holidays. Anyway, it means you represent very large clients, and I represented the largest of the large. Fortune 100, Fortune 500 companies were my clientele. St. Louis Rams football team was a client. I know it's a shock because I still have yet to watch a full football game. They were a client. Advanta Bank was a client. Volkswagen was a client. You get the idea. And because my office was next door to the environmental law partner, I ended up doing environmental cases. And when you're charging the equivalent of $1,500 an hour per hour of work, Greenpeace is not your client. The ones who are raping and pillaging the planet are your client. And I felt very conflicted because I was a, you know, hug a sequoia tree, save a whale kind of girl. But then 10 years ago, 11 now, I forgot it's 2024, I was given an option to make amends for my prior life. And I got a chance to work as an in-house lawyer, general counsel for an anti-sex slavery nonprofit, and move to Asia, Southeast Asia part-time, and start running undercover crews of former Navy SEAL type SWAT team guys into the brothels so that we could get intel on which cartels were running, you know, the brothels, how many kids were in them, what languages did they speak, how old are they, are the guys at the door packing heat, is it a knife, is it an automatic weapon, are we going to have a firefight when we go to bust it? And we busted the brothels, and we got the bad guys put away, and we got the girls out and got them help, and I was awarded, rewarded. It was a lot of work to do, and you guys know this, I'm sure, but for those who may not, human trafficking is the fastest growing crime in the world, second largest, and it's about to take over drugs for the top spot for the simple reason that there's a hell of a lot more profit in selling a 7-year-old to a sex buyer than there is in selling cocaine to an addict. So that's a problem. So we were swimming upstream trying to do good work, and in 2013, Congressman Ed Royce out of Brea, right up the road there. He put together, he was the head of the House Foreign Affairs Committee at the time, but he put together a congressional committee to fight sex slavery and human slavery, and I was sitting on that for the last 10 years. And that's what I was busy doing very happily right up until March of 2020 when tyranny came to our town and you didn't have to go to Southeast Asia to find it in a brothel. And so in 2021, I was gracing Clay Clark and General Flynn's Reawaken stage in San Antonio, Texas. And I said, what did I say? I forget what I said. What did I say? I said that I believed that we are in the middle of a genocide. By the way, that's the brothel town I work in. I forgot to mention that. So there's a town in the deep south of Thailand that has 140 brothels in it and nothing else. And on the other side of the river sits Malaysia, where they have radical jihadi terror training cells. And those guys keep their bombing skills sharp by bombing the ever-loving hell out of the brothels over the river. So the first year I worked there in Southeast Asia, we had 330 bombs go off. It's one a day. And that's why when the haters are like, we're going to go protest in front of Leigh Dundas' house, I'm like, unless you got a bomb, I really don't care. Now I know why God had me there. Toughened your skin, but I digress. So that's the town when it's been bombed. Very sad. But when I was on Clay Clark's stage a couple years ago, I said, you know what? I really believe that we are in a genocide. Because when the DOD database has a 20 million increase in the rate of injury in the first 9 months after rollout of the vaccine over their normal plateau of normal incidence of disease and injury, you really can't call it anything other than a genocide. When you have a 40x increased risk of myocarditis, according to Pfizer, in our boys, and they knew that it was going to happen before they released it, you can't call it anything other than a genocide, right? That's what we're living through right now. And so I called it out like I saw it. A year prior, I was standing on the west steps of the Capitol, 2020, and I said, I believed we were on a bullet train to Auschwitz if we did not course correct. And even a lot of the freedom fighters who are with me now are like, I don't know, Leigh, that sounds a little bit hyperbolic. I was hoping I was wrong. I was not. The new Nazis have just figured out a much more clean and easy way to make us beg for the final solution with a needle in the arm. So much easier than shoving a jackboot into somebody's butt and forcing them in to an oven at Auschwitz. But make no mistake, it is a genocide, and we have been here before. 10 years ago, almost to the day, I was in the brothel I talked about in that town. We were doing a documentary, a film short. We were interviewing the girls there. Only one agreed to be interviewed. It was not her. It was her friend. She's about 12, 13 years old. She sat down on a chair like that in the corner of the brothel room. She had a peach organza little cotillion party dress on. And we asked her, did you know when you got to this town what you would be doing? Because in Europe, you rescue the kids out of the brothels. They're 18, 19 years old. And you go, hey, did you expect this to happen? And they're like, no, I'm a poor Roma gypsy girl, like my heritage, or I'm from Ukraine. Some recruiter said I was going to be a waitress in Greece, and then they drugged me, took my papers, and here I am, but I didn't expect this. It's a bait and switch. But that is not the case in Asia. In Asia, the families sell their children to the brothel, and we wanted to make that point. So we asked her, did you know when you got here what you would be doing? And this girl looked dead into the camera, and she said, I knew exactly what I'd be doing, but I'm not unhappy. And my very British colleague from London leans over and he goes, Leigh, we need to ask it again. Must have been a poor translation. Nobody's happy to be in a brothel. So we ask it again, did you know when you got here what you would be doing? And for the second time in as many minutes, this girl looks dead into the camera and repeats what she said. She said, I knew exactly what I'd be doing, but I am not unhappy. And then she explains, because my seven brothers and sisters have food on the table, and they're not starving to death, nor is my mother. 90% of the girls we rescue out of the Thailand brothels come from Sawanakit, Laos. What is Laos, and why do I tell you this? Laos is a currently communist country, and I tell you this so that you don't ever forget the ugly face that is communism, because make no mistake right now, we are in the midst of a communist overthrow of our own country. We have been here before. So It was last year. It was like 13 and a half months ago. Orange County, California, they decided they were going to do a second lockdown. We were still in the middle of our first one, from COVID. Still in the middle of our COVID lockdown, a million days later, and they're like, yeah, we're going to do a second lockdown. I'm like, we're already locked down. Why are you doing a second lockdown? What the hell kind of tyranny is this? Like, two lockdowns? Oh, yeah, for the RSV virus. And I'm like, yeah, we've been here before, and we're not doing that. And I debated as to whether I was going to talk about Hitler or Tiananmen Square. Y'all remember Tiananmen Square? 1989, we've been here before. A dozen students decided they wanted what we have. They wanted freedom. And a dozen students walked into Tiananmen Square in Beijing, China, and they locked arms and they sat peacefully praying and chanting. They wanted, in a nutshell, freedom of speech, freedom of religion, freedom of press. The freedoms that you and I have been busy ignoring and enjoying by turn since our great-great-great-great-grandpa got them for us. And so the days rolled on, and the dozen students became 100, and the 100 became 1,000, and the 1,000 became 100,000. And pretty soon, a few weeks on in, you had over a million students in the middle of Tiananmen Square. And at that point, the CCP decided they could no longer allow such an ignoble display on their watch. And they ordered their tanker commanders to roll into Tiananmen Square. But those tanker units couldn't get within a solid freaking mile of that square because those children were out there locking arms peacefully, chanting and singing and praying. And at that point, those tank commanders radioed back to headquarters and the order came down from on high from the CCP that they were to fire their weapons into unarmed children whose only crime was asking for freedom.
No one thought it would come to this. A brutal massacre of Chinese students and other protesters by the Chinese army.
The troops have been firing indiscriminately, but still, there are thousands of people on the streets who will not move back.
From Tiananmen Square, the sound of gunfire sounded like a battle, but it was one-sided.
After hours of shooting and facing a line of troops, the crowd is still here. They're shouting, "Stop the killing and down with the government."
In the streets, many came up to us, shaking with anger and disbelief and fear. Many were terrified, saying there would be retribution. There was not one voice on the streets which did not express despair and rage. Tell the world, they said to us.
Tell the world, they said. Tell the world. And so I do you? So I debated before I took my 2 minutes on the mic at Orange County, California, November a year ago, if I was going to remind them of Tiananmen or Hitler, and I went with Hitler.
Ladies and gentlemen.
Human rights attorney Leigh Dundas, some years ago, two men sat at a table discussing the most effective way to usher in war. Their decision after discussion was to close non-essential businesses and further quarantine certain members of society to prevent the spread of disease known as typhus. These men's names? Joseph Goebbels and Adolf Hitler. You think you're special. I am here to tell you, you are not. You are the new Fourth Reich. And I have news for you today. We will not be locking down or taking funding over RSV, which 90% of children contract before the age of two, and only 100 to 500 a year die, which is a 0.00000472813 death rate. It is 0.41%. You will not get more blood money into this county. You will not get more state or federal funding for our hospitals. This is not an emergency. To do so is fraud. You will not mask us like she just talked about doing. You will not quarantine the well or the sick. You will not keep our kids out of school. And damn right, you're not going to cripple our businesses anymore. Do you hear me? We will never lock down again. This is the hill we die on because this is America. This is the Constitution of America. And this is frickin' freedom. Never again.
Thank you. Thank you. So, like I said, I can't do math or science. It's all one lane for me. So they didn't give a rat's ass, pardon my French. They enacted that lockdown. But the next day I woke up and that video was going viral on Twitter, which I don't even have. In South Africa and the back end of Aboriginal Perth, where tribal leaders were like, I don't know who that white woman is, but damn right, we never locking down again, never again. And I'm like, wow, okay. And so without asking, Orange County pulled its punch. They rolled it back. They stopped running ticker tape saying, oh my gosh, we're running out of pediatric beds because the RSV, COVID, same playbook. They just did away with it because the thing they fear is having their crimes outed. This is called name and shame. I've done one of these types of programs every month or every week for the last 47 and a half months, and I have had a 100% success rate. But I am the only one, thank you, I am the only one running these plays, and that begs the question as to why. And we need more of this, pardon my French, we do. And so today, I'm going to give you my little handbook, now that I've patented these moves over the last 47 months. The Freedom Fighters Handbook is like a Ranger field guide, like a Navy SEAL blueprint for taking out your particular Osama bin Laden. Immediate action drills to defend your family from woke you-know-what. So... So before I give you the handbook, though, because your brain is going to want to reject what I say out of hand, I am going to tell you why your brain doesn't like to hear the new kid on the block plan, okay? So the first thing to know is our brains are hardwired to be very, very obedient. There was a guy by the name of Stanley Milgram. He was a Yale University professor back in the 60s, and he wanted to see if the Holocaust was a result of a little man with a mustache, or if maybe it had something to do with the obedience level of the good Germans. So he ran an experiment to sort of suss this out. It was an obedience experiment, but he didn't call it that. He called it a memory experiment. So the people coming in thought they were going to be tested on their memory. And he invited all comers, you know, auto mechanics and nurses and teachers and postal workers and politicians and kids in college, everybody, retired folk. And when they came in, they get paired up in a group of two. And they'd be given a word list of arbitrary word pairings. So when I say camel, you say cat. And then they'd break up the group, they'd put her in one room, me in another room, and I would say the word camel, and my buddy was supposed to know to say the word cat. When the wrong answer came back, this is where it gets interesting, I was supposed to hit a little switch on the wall that would deliver a little shock to my buddy in the next room to negatively reinforce the wrong answer. And the voltages, the switches started at 9 volts, which is nothing to write home about. We've all licked a battery, right? Three of us have licked a battery. You know what I'm talking about there in the front. Okay, 9-volt battery, you're in third grade, your best friend's like, lick the battery, like, okay, you don't do it twice. Yeah. Many batteries. All right, so it's not pleasant, but it doesn't kill you. But the switches went all the way up. You had to hit a higher one for every wrong answer. And the voltages capped out at 450 volts. And that is, for those of you who aren't good at science like me, I'll just tell you right now, that is a fatal dose of electricity. That's electric chair voltage. And unbeknownst to me, nobody was actually getting injured in the next room when I'm flipping the switches. I'm hearing pre-recorded right and wrong answers and pre-recorded sounds of pain. So in the beginning, toward the 9 volts, it's, ugh, you know, ow. And as I'm going up in voltage, it's, oh my gosh, that's really hurting me. You gotta stop. And then it's just abject crying, screaming, begging, dude, you're gonna give me a heart attack. Please stop shocking me. Which creates no small amount of cognitive dissonance, upset emotionally on the part of the person who's actually being studied, which is the person in my chair. Usually, the person in my chair at some point turns to the guy in control of the experiment, a researcher in a very starchly stiff white lab coat with the name Dr. So-and-so very prominently emblazoned across his lapel. And the guy goes, hey, I thought this was a memory experiment. I'm not cool. Like, he sounds like he's dying in there. I want to stop. And for his part, the Confederate of Milgram had been coached to just say three simple words. There was no gun to the person's head. There was no, oh, I'm going to lock the door. You have to finish the experiment. You can't leave until you... No. Three little words. You must continue. And the question is, what percentage of average law-abiding, God-fearing, normal American men and women with not so much as a parking ticket on their record would continue to shock their neighbor to death over a wrong answer on a memory quiz just because somebody in a position of authority over them said they must? And when Stanley Milgram shopped it to his colleagues, they're like, dude, you're high. The only people who are going to not walk out and stay there all the way to the bitter end are the sadists who like, you know, shocking other people. Everybody else is going to walk out. And he goes, well, let's find out, shall we? So he runs the experiment. Want to take a wild guess as to how many people were perfectly fine nuking their neighbor to death? Close. 2 out of 3, 65.5%. Slightly higher in the Asian countries, who are more obedient traditionally to authority. Slightly less than that in the Nordic countries, who are more Norwegian. We're going to make an ice cave. We don't care what people think. But generally speaking, it shook out over and over again. at 2 out of 3. I think we're more obedient now than we were then. So that is the first thing I am fighting when I'm giving you a playbook is you want to be obedient to the same old stuff. Our brains do. It's just the way they're wired. Okay, second thing that we're fighting is normality bias. Wait, I think I forgot something. Oh, no. It's the programming, right? Everybody in this room knows about Operation Mockingbird. If you don't, I'll give you the 10-second version. In the 50s, the CIA decided they wanted to control the media narrative, and they recruited journalists into being CIA operatives, and they trained CIA operatives and put them in the journalistic outfits, print and broadcast news, TV and print, Time Magazine, the whole nine yards, to run their narrative. And then the church committee, Congressman Church, did a whole rigmarole in the 70s to get to the bottom of this shady stuff. It's a real thing. It's not a conspiracy theory. Look up the church committee hearings. And at that point, President Bush, who was in charge of the CIA, goes, oh, yeah, we don't pay for the privilege of getting journalists to run our narrative anymore. But what he didn't say is, we don't run the narrative anymore.
The sharing of biased and
false news has become all too common on social media.
More alarming, some media is part of the public's attention to the truth. Unfortunately, some of the media is part of your own personal bias and agenda control.
This is exactly what people think, and this is extremely dangerous to our democracy.
Damn right it's extremely dangerous to our democracy, but not what they were saying. I think they were talking about censorship. The thing that's dangerous is the fact that they're all reading from the same script. Either they're more psychic than the lady in the next room. We are at the Conscious Life Expo. I couldn't resist. They're more psychic than everybody in the damn building. Or you have to consider that if broadcast journalists from Bangor, Maine to Dallas, Texas to Malibu are saying the exact same words at the exact same time, 50 people across America, maybe it's a pushed narrative. Maybe, maybe, maybe. Third thing that we're fighting is normality bias, okay? When we are faced with an abnormal situation, our body, our brains just want to do the usual. We are creatures of habit. So you can think of it like this. Say I'm a soccer mom, true enough. Say I live in Orange County, also true. Say I drop my kid at preschool, not true, she's in college now. But say I drop her, you know, in Huntington Beach at her preschool, and then every Monday morning I get in my car and I drive down PCH and I go to my yoga class. Except tomorrow, I get in my car and I'm looking off to the left side. Instead of seeing some nice rolling waves, I see that. Right? That's the first thing your brain does. Oh my gosh, what the heck, okay? And the first step of normality bias is your brain goes in denial. That can't be a tidal wave. I live in Huntington Beach, not Bora Bora. Mm-mm, not a tidal wave. It might look like one, but I'm pretty sure that's not a tidal wave. Not a river in Egypt. Denial is a real thing. It happens here too. Second step of normality bias is your brain and your eyeballs take another look at the really big wave and they go, I don't know, Scooter, kind of looks like a tidal wave. I mean, I've never seen one in real life, but it's a really big wave. And then the other half of your brain goes, nah, can't be. And you are warring with yourself. You are Q&A. You are analysis paralysis. You are deer in the headlight. Looks like a car. No, no, I'm just going to go across the meadow and get something to eat. Dude, there's a car coming. No, not a car. Right? Something like 80%+ of human beings, when faced with war, natural disasters, anything unusual to a severe degree, experience normality bias. Count, 8 out of 10, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, you two don't. Count, okay? You get the idea of the numbers? 60% plus of people who die in natural disasters die because they never get past 1 and 2 and into where you need to be, which is decisive action, where your brain goes, dude, I don't know, I've never seen a tidal wave before, but that was a big damn wave. Call it a tidal wave, call it what you will. We're gonna point the car toward the hills so we survive to see another day. And you save yourself, okay? You can drill this to lower the reaction time of you, your spouse, your kids, and you should, because your brain doesn't know the difference between a drill and real life. So you get in the car, and instead of looking at the boob tube in the back with the kids, right, you go, hey, babe, what would happen if a giraffe jumped in front of the car? Ah, Mom, we're in America, not Africa. That would never happen. Right? That's what your kids are going to say. Okay, but humor me. What if it did? I don't know. We could use your cell phone to call for help. Great. Say my cell phone's dead. What could you do then? Mom, all right, well, I guess we could stop the car and put the emergency hazard lights on. Great, honey, what else? Okay, I guess we could wait for a break in traffic and go across the street and into the store and use their landline to call the animal control people. Great, what else, what else? You don't care what they say. You care that they say something, anything, because any plan will more than likely save you versus no plan at all and staring like a deer in the headlights, okay? So these are the three things that are hindering our ability to quit doing what we've always done in America, which is lawsuits and legislation, and start doing the things we need to do because we are in a different kind of war right now. And even amongst the freedom fighters, the people I know and love, the organizations that I work with, I've worked with Simone, she paid me for a month, I set up CHD Cali, Bobby Kennedy, I know these people, I like these people, I work with PERC. There's not a single lawyer from here to the Mississippi and even on the other side with Tom Renz that I don't know that I don't work with. I love them all. I love them all, and I love the people in my audience, but we are still stuck in Del Taco land.
Excellent. Excellent. Just excellent. How about lunch?
Same place.
Same place.
Same thing.
Same thing.
Creatures of habit. That's what people become when it's time to eat.
Same place.
Same place.
Same thing.
Same thing.
Same place.
Time to get out of the rut and into Del Taco, where everything we make is habit-breaking.
Same place,
same place,
same thing,
same thing.
Don't be a creature of habit. Come into Del Taco, not the same place, not the same thing.
Don't be a creature of habit. If you told me at age 10 and 82 when I first saw that commercial that I would be quoting it as a teaching tool from the stage 4 decades later, I would have been pretty sure you were smoking the good stuff. All right, so we are not yet out of Del Taco land, even amongst the Conscious Life Awakened crowd. And I'm going to prove it to you right now. One, are we at war? Okay, everybody agrees. Good. And are we winning it or not quite yet? Okay, not quite yet. This is a fifth generation war, yes? Bombs aren't going off yet in our country. It's an information war, okay? And you need to fight it on a disinformation, information basis. And by the way, even the real wars, the ones where the bombs go off, like Hitler, even those wars are decided based on PR and information. So if you didn't know this, at the end of World War II, Hitler's Minister of War was interviewed, and he said, oh yeah, all the battles that Hitler won didn't have anything to do with my department. So again, if you didn't know this, Germany had gifted every single family in the country a radio. And every factory, every workplace, every town square, every church got loudspeakers. They didn't care about the people. They wanted to brainwash them. And so at the end of the war, when this guy, the Minister of War, was asked about it, he goes, yeah, it wasn't my department. He said, and the quote was, through technological innovation, like the adoption of radio and loudspeaker, 80 million people were deprived of independent thought, such that by the end of the war, the good Germans would stand in their farmland and watch the cattle cars to Auschwitz go by and not even bat an eye. That's how you get her done. If you're a totalitarian dictator, Khrushchev, 1956, switching from fascism to communism, said, I will take America without firing a single shot. I will destroy you from within. Right? And then 8 years later, 1963, into our open congressional record, 45 communist goals. These were the goals for the takeover of the U.S. I don't have time to go into all this, but granting recognition of Red China, capturing one or both political parties, gaining control of the schools to use them as a conveyor belt for the purveyance of communist socialist propaganda, destroying the nuclear family by normalizing perversion, normalizing divorce, taking away our Constitution and our founding fathers, so on and so forth. They're more than halfway there, and the proof is in the pudding. Because right now, when you ask our children, our college and high school age youth, do you think it would be cool to live in a communist or socialist country? Fully 51% think it would be cool to live in North Korea or Cuba. By the way, the answer to this is in your hands. Quit taking your children, grandchildren, and nieces and nephews to the Grand Canyon and Disney World. You take them to Cambodia like I did with my daughter at age 8, and you run them through the killing fields, and they won't ever answer that question wrong, because they'll understand that the only thing communism gets you is an axe in the back so that you're buried in a 1 foot shallow grave, such that 50 frickin' years later, when I go to Cambodia during their typhoon season, the skeletal bones are still rising up out of those graves. The answer is in our hands. All right, so notwithstanding the fact that we all acknowledge that we're at war and that it's an information war, different type of war, 100% of the NGOs, the non-governmental organizations, the nonprofits in our freedom fighting space are using two and only two tools right now, lawsuits and legislation. They are not effective. I repeat, they are not effective on a communist playing field. At no point ever has a lawsuit won a war. You never went to history class in junior year and had your professor or your teacher say, now class, turn to page 82 today, and we're going to find how a really clever lawyer named Leigh got us out of Vietnam, Korea, the Revolutionary War. No, no, 1,000 times no, okay? And it's not that the tools aren't effective in certain contexts, they are. But you don't use a lawsuit to get rid of war. You don't ever use a lawsuit or legislation in a communist country like the ones I work in with the brothels, not if you want to get anything done. But But it's not about the tool. If you have a flat, when you go out to your car, like Maura had a dead battery the other night, that's how we bonded. Say she'd had a flat tire. If I were able to give her a tire iron and a jack, we could have had that thing changed in 5 minutes flat. If I give her a knife and a spoon, we might get it changed in 5 years between the two of us. It's not about the tool. Knives and spoons are great for dinner. But you don't change a flat tire with them, okay? So right now, the NGOs are doing two tools, lawsuits, legislation. They are less than 10% effective in the blue states. I have run the math. I've consulted on all of these cases. I don't take them. I farm them out because I know how the ending is going to go and I refuse to waste my time. And this is where we're at. Can we afford to be having our Navy SEALs shooting bullets 100 times and only hitting 1 to 10? You want your kid to see the next year, the next decade? The answer is no, we can't afford that kind of a success rate because it ain't a success rate. Two other truths. The generals alone will not win this war. They never do. They call the shots, and then the Army charges the hill and takes the hill. I love Bobby. I love Trump. I love Flynn. I love Tom Renz. I love Judy Mikovits. I love Malone and McCullough and Ed Dowd. Like, I know them all. We work together. Love them. Not enough of us. We need to be joined by an army. The reason we're in a second Holocaust, in my opinion, is this planet didn't learn the lesson it should have the first time. FDR and Churchill rescued people. What should have happened is the good German should have stood up and said, hell no, Hitler, you're a schizophrenic, high on meth, and we are not baking our neighbors in ovens. If they had just done that, it would have been over before it started. That's the lesson we are meant to win. Final thing, this army needs to be armed with tools it can use. Raise your hand if you're a lawyer. Look around, put your head on a swivel stick. Okay, there you are. Sorry, you're in the shadow. Okay, so there's two of us, not enough of us to get it done, okay? And here's the thing, the average ma and pa sitting in Des Moines, Iowa, flyover country, you know, Bangor, Maine, he needs something he can do to get rid of drag queen story hour or a new law that's going to allow girls to cut off their breasts and call themselves men without telling their parents or whatever the thing is, right? And that tool, that weapon, needs to not require a boatload of money because most people don't have it, especially after the last 3 years. It needs to not require a law school degree because none of you have that. And it also needs to not require Bobby Kennedy's Rolodex. And guess what lawsuits and legislation require, even if they were effective in the blue states, which they're not. They require all of that. So we need to get something into the hands of the people that actually works. And that is what we're going to be talking about today. I'm going to give you this Freedom Fighter Handbook, immediate action drills on how you can do what I've been doing, which is not lawsuits or legislation, to actually get somewhere and get something done. So the first kind of program is Name and Shame. How this works, there's three programs. Name and Shaming your bully into submission. Bullying your little bully into submission by getting a bigger bully to hit your bully on the head until he drops the bad plan. And then figuratively speaking, if the deep state's listening, of course. And then the third one is the Power of the People United initiatives, kind of like the convoy that we ran. So the name and shame steps, this is a recipe. It's like Betty Crocker. Feel free to write it down or take a picture. They're really simple. You find the bad plan. You find the guy pushing it. You research him. You want to find anything in his closet that he doesn't want known. Illegal, unethical skeletons in the closet, or things that just make the average person go, he did what? Anything like that. And then you put it on blast. You cannot go up to the politician and go, hey, I found out that you cheated on your wife and your taxes and you have a Hunter Biden laptop. And if you don't do what I want you to do, I'm going to blackmail you. Because that's called blackmail. It's a federal crime. You'll go to prison for like 10 years or something. So don't do that. But there is nothing that stops you from finding the warts on his whatever record and putting that on blast. That's called your First Amendment right. So the first time I saw this done was St. Petersburg, Florida, 2013-ish, they were having a huge problem with sex trafficking, huge. And nothing was putting a dent in it, thank you. And finally, the health department goes, you know what we're gonna do? When we arrest the guys who are buying the girls, we're gonna put their name and likeness, their picture, their mugshot, on a big old billboard, really crisp, full color, glossy, high def, name in big black letters along with their crimes, and then, which was good, it was a good start. And then they went one step further. They wrote a letter to the wife that went, you know, we call the guys Johns, right? Dear Mrs. John, you probably don't know this, but your husband was arrested on a bad side of St. Petersburg, Florida on Saturday night for soliciting underage girls for sex, and it wasn't his first offense. Accordingly, we were thinking it might be prudent for you to route yourself to the nearest STD clinic and get checked for AIDS, chlamydia, gonorrhea, and syphilis so you don't die a premature death. Sincerely, your loving local health department. You want to know how quickly the incidence of sex trafficking in St. Pete dropped? Overnight by 24.5%. If you are remotely into statistics and math, doing a program and getting 4% movement on the dial is considered a win. To drop something a quarter overnight, oh, hello. That tells you it works. So I learned that, and I thought, that's interesting. First time I got a chance to do it was spring of 2020. They got rid of our Orange County health officer in the middle of his term, and they replaced him with this charming woman named Nicole Quick. And she rolled out a mask mandate walking into Memorial Day weekend, Friday at midnight, which is always when I release the work I'm most proud of, midnight of a holiday weekend. Three people passed out while they were exercising from lack of oxygen. In case you didn't know this, just like your car needs gas to run, your body actually needs oxygen. If you deprive it, your kidneys will fail and eventually your heart will stop too. Anyway, so she had done this lovely little thing and everybody came running up to me and they're like, Leigh, are you gonna file a lawsuit? I'm like, no. I read the law. It gives her complete unfettered discretion. It's a horrible law, but she has the right to do it under that law. Are you gonna change the law? I'm like, have you been to Sacramento this lifetime? They're communists up there, like avowed communists. There's like DAs in San Francisco who are members of the Communist Party. Like, no, they're crazy up there. They're not going to change the law. They like the law. I'm like, what are you going to do? And I'm like, well, give me a minute. So I called my private eyes, and I said, her name's Nicole Quick. I want to know her better than I know my own husband. Tracking? They're like, roger that. So they called me back, and they found some good stuff. Wasn't illegal, but it was good stuff. And then I wrote a letter to the Board of Supes, and I said, I'm going to be there on Tuesday. I just wanted to give you a heads up that I think you fell down on your due diligence. I'll tell you more on Tuesday. You can't put all the good stuff in the letter because then they just hide it. And that's not a name and shame if it doesn't go public. You need to save the good stuff for the mic. So this is what it looked like.
My name is Leigh Dundas. I'm an attorney. I'm going to direct my comments to the last six words of agenda item two.
I'll let you guys do your thing. So anyway, go for it. Well, after I fought down the second lockdown, we are always the first county hit. Orange County, California is the first county hit. No offense to LA. You guys are a lost cause up here. There's actual communists in Camarillo County.
Directions to staff during times of COVID, specifically local health officer Nicole Quick. Under health and safety code 10-1000, you appointed her. By the way, I love you guys, but I have some very harsh words for you right now.
We lost Pete again.
You appointed this woman, which by extension means you can unappoint her. And Sheriff Barnes is absolutely correct when he said under health and safety code 10-10-29, he can enforce the order, but he by no means has to, and it sounds like he won't. I want to backfill some of the due diligence I think was missing before her hiring. This woman is entirely unqualified for the job she now holds. After she graduated from medical school in Utah, her sole claim to fame is she went to work for her mother's methadone clinic where she was writing Suboxone prescriptions for heroin addicts. That is right. She was prescribing one opiate to guys who were trying to get off their favorite opiate. And then she came out of the sticks of Utah and made a brief pass at Yuba before she was lured down here with $168,000 a year job. And she brought her boyfriend, Spencer Price, who was her mother's office manager at that methadone clinic, to come down here, and they made a nice little home for themselves in Irvine until 3 days ago when she took aim at the health and welfare of every single resident in this county. She needs to be fired. She needs to be fired because she is taking aim at our health. Okay, she just put a target on our back. When you wear a mask, particularly outside, it drops your oxygen level hypoxically low, and that precipitates fatalities, which is why two kids running in China 2 weeks ago died while they were wearing a mask. If she wants to play Russian roulette with the health and safety of our county, I am going to one-up her. We are going to go to her front yard in front of her sidewalk in Irvine. We're going to do calisthenics and masks on her front doorstep, and when people start dropping like flies, and they will, I am going to ask every single first responder in a 30-mile radius to roll lights and sirens to her front door, and you had best pray that they can revive whoever went down, because if they can't, I will be asking, I'm going to wrap up OCDA's office to charge it as murder, because that is what it is. If you don't want, last sentence, this dog and pony show I am delivering to her front door on yours, you need to roll it back.
Dozens of the north steps of this.
So that was spring of... 21, I think. It was spring of 2020. It was when they did the mask mandates. So here's the deal. Going back to this gentleman's question, we are the first county hit because if they can get a conservative county of 5 people and 55 cows north of Yolo County to do it, it doesn't tell them anything. If they can get LA, San Fran, and Sac to do it, it doesn't tell them anything. You guys are already under communist rule. If they can get a large conservative county to bend over and take it, they know they can take the state, and after the state, the nation, and as goes the country, so goes the world. We are ground zero right down the 5 freeway in Orange County, and even if I didn't live there, I'd be fighting tooth and nail because that is the battle line, that is the front lines. When I fought down the RSV secondary lockdown, sir, immediately they started derailing trains. They moved. They knew they couldn't do a second lockdown playbook, that we were over it. They switched to environmental disasters. Same war, different play that they did. So you never make a promise you don't keep. After I said, if you don't like this dog and pony show I'm delivering to her front door, you need to roll it back or I'll bring it to your front door. Okay, the Board of Supervisors don't want all of us with bullhorns in front of where they live. They can cut your mic at a board meeting. It doesn't get any skin off their nose. They do not want you in front of their house. So I had released her home address. I scrubbed it from this version on live TV, Channel 3. And we had big old signs made, and there were only about 15 pissed off parents. They went down to her house in Irvine. She was so scared during the meeting, she got up and she left. Followed her to her house in Irvine. Somebody had made 7 foot tall, 20 foot long, red and black signs, hooked them to a panel van. We had one facing her house, one on the backside to catch the, you know, passing traffic. And we were greeted by the entirety of Irvine Police Department's finest, men in blue. And some young buck came up to me and he's like, who's in charge? And I'm like, who said anybody has to be in charge? We're just Americans using our constitutional rights. He goes, I'll assume you're in charge. I'm like, probably guilty, okay? And he's like, well, I'm just here to tell you, ma'am, that you can't step over this line because that's her. I'm like, oh, honey, I've been practicing law longer than you've been alive. I don't think you're shaving yet, are you? It doesn't really look like it. I will finish your story. I can't step here because that is my health officer's property. But you know what this right here is called? This is called public thoroughfare. And me and all my friends can be here all damn day, all damn night, and all damn month. And since we got such a wonderful reception, I think we might just stay all month. And as long as I don't go over the sound ordinance that cuts in at 10 p.m. to 6 a.m., I can be here with my bullhorns doing whatever the hell I want as long as it's not illegal. Go review your constitution. And by the way, you might want to call your watch commander and get a hell of a lot more overtime approved. And they had unmarked detectives sitting in cars around the block. And we took a little walk and we stood right in front of the window and the guy's rolling his window up and putting his visor shield up. So I come back and I see that there's somehow my private eyes had forgot to mention the girl had kids. And she's got a little tiny eye in the sky camera over her gate, her courtyard gate, wrought iron gate, so I could see through it. And I'm like, there's rollerblades and little bitty sandy buckets. I looked up at her little eye in the sky and I go, let me tell you what I didn't have time to say on the mic in my 3 minutes. I know that your daddy left your MD mommy in the sticks of Mormon country, Utah. And she was so upset, she spent all her money hiring private eyes and psychics to track him down to no avail. And you were so upset, you did every term paper from sophomore year of high school all the way through college and grad school on men who leave their wives. But what I didn't know, my dear, is that you have babies. But I'm a soccer mom. I know what that means. Looks like your kids are 2 and 4 years old, my dear. Listen well and listen good. You better make damn sure they are masked from their little bitty eyeballs all the way down to their clavicle the moment they step out your front door, because if they're not, I'm going to be rolling tape. Give me a week. You won't want to know my name. She quit. She quit. If it's not illegal to go in front of where they live, that is where you get traction. St. Petersburg, Florida didn't get traction off the billboards. They got traction off of outing the guy's crimes to the wife and making her fear for her life that she had AIDS. Get the spouses involved. When they can't get their car out of the garage to go to Costco, and when their kids are like, Mommy, why can't I use my scooter? That's when divorce starts to happen, and you'll get them to drop your bad plan. All right, so moving on, I did the same thing that the second in command at the California State Department of Health, a doctor by the name of Charity Dean. She was a Santa Barbara County health officer back in the 20-teens, and she decided to have all of her nurses fax all of the medical exemption vaccine records in the county to her so she could play judge, jury, and executioner. Nothing in the law allowed her to do that. And it was a violation in my book of HIPAA and various other federal laws that make your kids privacy rights adhere to their medical records, and, you know, kind of a crime. But, of course, this is California, so instead of being prosecuted and fired, she was rewarded for her criminal activity by being elevated to the second in command of the California State Department of Health, where she was holding court as COVID hit. So right before COVID hit, I put her crimes on blast on the west steps of the Sacramento Capitol.
Dozens of the north steps of the state capitol, the anti-vaccination group Advocates for Physicians' Rights is calling on the Department of Justice to investigate the creation of SB 276.
Full-scale investigation of the county health officers, medical doctors, nurses, and other licensed professionals.
Reporting live at the state capitol tonight, Doug Johnson, Fox 40.
We headlined every single mainstream news station, 6, 8, and 10 p.m., I had not one but two senators for the first time ever come out of the Capitol and join our press conference, one of whom spoke. And everybody came up to me, and they were like, okay, Leigh, so that was really impressive, and you got more time on the mic, but, you know, what's the result? What's the result? I'm like, give it a minute. So I also wrote a 15-page letter to the state and the federal agencies, HHS, all the ones that are, you know, required to prosecute people like this. And I listed all her crimes. And I sent it off, and then she got resigned slash fired, whatever you want to call it, right around the time our Orange County health officer did, at which point Cal Matters, a NorCal newspaper, figured out that Leigh Dundas was the common denominator. They're like, you, when Leigh Dundas shows up and angrily wags her finger, you better watch your back. Like, well, I do a little more than wag. But my point in sharing this, thank you guys for the love, is that you can do it too. There's absolutely nothing I did here that was anything I learned in law school. I was a pissed off parent. I did research. I figured out where their bad stuff was, and I put it on blast, and everybody here can do that. So another time I did this was with the head of the Federal Aviation Agency. If you didn't know this, that man, Steve Dixon, allowed the airlines to mandate a non-FDA-approved protocol into the bodies of the pilots, which is completely a violation of federal law, which requires our pilots not only to never fly with non-FDA-approved stuff in their system, but also not to fly with newly FDA-approved stuff. So if they approve a diabetes drug today, you and you and you and me could take it. I would never do that, but you probably wouldn't either. But the pilots can't take it for another year. Why? Because the FDA is like, yo, you're in charge of a plane at 30,000 feet, and in case there's an adverse effect that the FDA missed, we don't want that to turn on when you're, you know, carrying 700 innocent passengers up there. But notwithstanding all that, that's the federal law. Yeah, they mandated, right? And so we lost five pilots from the same airline in the first week of December 21. And that's when all the pilots came up to me, and they're like, hello? Can you help us? And I'm like, all right. So I wrote a little love letter. We did a press conference at Turning Point or CPAC or one at Turning Point. But I also wrote a love letter to Steve Dixon, the head of the FAA, and the CEOs of American, Delta, United, Southwest, so on, listing all their crimes. And I got all my good friends. Bobby Kennedy agreed to sign it, Mary Holland, Reiner Fulmick, the military whistleblowers, the doctors who blew the whistle on the military DOD database that I got out there. And we all signed it. And then I waited. And everybody goes, the letter's done. Why are you waiting? I'm like, I'm waiting for Christmas. I called my PIs, and I'm like, I need these boys' home addresses. And they're like, oh, like the one in D.C.? I'm like, no, not Steve Dixon's home apartment in D.C. I'm talking his Peachtree, Georgia address where his wife's going to be at Christmas. Like, oh, okay. They got me the address. I wait till about 3 o'clock. I have my process servers. It wasn't a lawsuit. It was just a letter. Process servers go up to the home address in Peachtree, Georgia. You know, do the military cop knock. And Mrs. Dixon, how do you get traction? You involve the wives. Remember that role? Mrs. Dixon opens the door with her hand up the butt of a turkey and her other hand on her grandkid's head to get this little love bomb thrown into her universe. I also CC'd all the insurance companies are going to be required to pay a multi-billion dollar payout when, not if, a plane goes down with all of us on board. And it only took a couple weeks before Steve Dixon, in the middle of his term, can you imagine that, stepped down and they started talking about holding closed-door hearings to figure out how to fix this problem, which isn't so fixable after you've got the pilot jabbed, but whatever. So again, this is how you get her done. Final time, one of the final times I did this was OC superintendent of our schools, Al Maharis, was conspiring with our local health officer, the guy who took over after I got the other one fired, and they decided they were going to secretly COVID vaccinate children on our school campuses with no informed consent being sought and without even telling you about it. So let me break it down. Little Johnny gets dropped off for kindergarten. Bye, sweetie, I'll see you at noon. He goes trotting off into recess. Nurse Ratchet comes out. Hey, Johnny, follow me into my office. You're gonna get a little glazed sugar donut. I know it's your favorite. Bam, Johnny comes home. 3 days later, he's playing soccer with your brothers and sisters and drops dead of a heart attack at age 5, and you're none the wiser because you didn't even know. And I said, oh, hell no, we're not doing this.
Leigh Dundas, human rights attorney. Late last week, I am informed a meeting occurred between Orange County Health Officer Dr. Clayton Chow and Orange County Board of Education Superintendent Al Maharas, during which time they apparently tried to find a way to, quote, sidestep and entirely remove informed parental consent for the COVID vaccine and also turn Orange County school campuses into vaccination centers. The COVID-19 vaccine is an experimental medical protocol authorized under the Emergency Use Authorization Act, and as such, you cannot mandate it for anyone, nor can you sidestep informed consent. There is a reason that kids cannot smoke, drive, drink, have sex, vote, or die for this country, and it is because the law says they lack the capacity to understand those decisions, and that applies here more than ever. Hear me loud and hear me well. We will not be morphing our school campuses into COVID vaccine centers for delivery of an experimental medical protocol that killed every ferret in the last animal study they did until such time they had to abandon that study, and then they didn't even do the study this time around because we are the study. The last time humans launched a plan like this to conduct experimental medical protocols on vulnerable populations was in Joseph Mengele's direction. He was an MD known as the Angel of Death, okay? And he was part of the SS, and in 1943, he was assigned to Auschwitz, where he saw an opportunity to conduct gene research, quote, focused primarily on children with no regard for the health or safety of the victims. This is off the internet, you can Google it. You know what else is gene research? Experimental COVID vaccines with the trans gene inside of it. If you don't believe me, go pull the EUA application for the J&J shot. I come from a long line of Eastern Europeans, Hungarians, and Romanian groups that fled the persecution of the Red Terror communist death squads in the early 1900s, and those of us who didn't make it to America ended up facing the Nazi death squads in the lesser-known Holocaust that was the Romani Holocaust. There is a reason my daughter is named Katia. Her Romani great-grandmother was Caterina Choma, and I, for one, have not forgotten the lessons of our history. The Third Reich did not end with experiments on children, nor when those children died. The Third Reich ended in 1946 when we put the doctors who committed these human experiments on trial in Nuremberg, and then we put them to death. It ended with the adoption of the Nuremberg Code so we would never repeat the sins of history. And it states, and I quote, the voluntary consent of this human subject is absolutely essential. Dr. Chow and Dr. Maharas, you are hereby on notice. Last week, you appear to have knowingly hatched a plan to sidestep and or violate international, federal, and state law, not just the Nuremberg informed consent language, but also the black letter law of the EUA, as well as California state law, which punishes, and I quote, the willful failure to obtain a subject's informed consent by imprisonment in county jail for 1 year or the imposition of a $50,000 fine or both. Through the planned insertion of experimental gene-altering protocols onto the very children, you were elected and charged with protecting. And tonight we are asking the Board of Education for an immediate letter of censure to these individuals. And if they don't resign, for an immediate notice of termination. And that letter also needs to go to the professional boards because they have no business being in these positions. So help me God, the people of Orange County will hold this policy to account.
Thank you. Nothing I learned in law school taught me to do that. And I did not know if lack of informed consent was simply a bad idea in California or a crime. I did what every single person in this room can do. I got on Google, not even DuckDuckGo, and I typed into it, lack of informed consent, California law. And it pulled up a criminal law. And that is what you heard me quote in the last paragraph. By the imposition of a $50,000 fine or a year in jail or both. You can do this too. No law degree required. I woke up the next morning and this thing was going so freaking viral. I'm like, what do people in Croatia care about Orange County's Board of Education? My husband's like, you were talking a little more broadly than that, babe. And here's the beautiful thing. When you can do a name and shame and you've got elected officials who have licenses, medical doctors that rest on not committing crimes of moral turpitude, and you've got them in a potentially illegal action, and you just put that on blast, they get very pucker factor-ish. You know what I'm talking about? They're like, They dropped that shit so fast, pardon my French, it was faster than a duck on a June bug, okay? But it was in part because it went so viral. 4 months later, I'm getting it back with Croatian and Japanese subtitles. And I tell you this not to gild my halo. But I tell you this because the more viral you can get it to go, that's where the leverage is. When the whole world is looking at what this one guy did, that guy gets so hella nervous and they just back off. They go after other low-hanging fruit. And that is how a name and shame program works. You can do it too. Okay, so we've covered name and shame. Find the bad plan. Find the guy pushing the bad plan. Research it. Research him. Put anything good and juicy you find on blast and they will drop it. Total expenditure zero to about $20 at Walmart and Kinko's. Versus 500 grand, a two-year lawsuit that we would have for sure lost. Okay? I'm not into burning donor money. I am into now doing mini fundraisers because for 4 years I've been entirely self-funded and I am not Bobby Kennedy and I do not have a trust fund. So we have had no paycheck. I did this out of my own savings account and I'm out. So if you want to fund me a little mini fundraiser in LA or wherever, I'll even come into communist LA. I would welcome that. Come talk to me after. Okay, bullying your bully into submission. The first time I did this, remember when Newsom enacted the lockdown and he said we can reopen if we hit XYZ metrics? 6 weeks, give or take, later, we'd hit them. And then Newsom, being Newsom, was like, just kidding, I'm going to move the goalpost way over here. You have to meet all these extra hurdles now to reopen. You're not going to be reopened this summer. No Dodger games for you. Remember that? So he did that on a Friday night, walking into, I forget what weekend, but we were up in SAC that weekend holding a please let us work rally, things you never thought you'd say when you don't live in North Korea, but you live in California. And I knew what Newsom was going to do. I fight wars in communist countries. So I took my boat, which has a very tall profile. It's like, you know, the grab rails up here. And that was my portable stage, and it was still attached to the truck so that we could pull out a Dodge if it got real. And my husband's like, you're getting on the boat with a podium and a business suit, and I'm your getaway driver? I'm like, exactly, babe. You got it, babe. Ex-military, Bonnie and Clyde, here we go. So, remember this weekend? We had breastfeeding moms sitting on the grass. The grass was open. They'd not barricaded the grass off. We had a right to be there. Breastfeeding moms, toddlers running around. We were holding signs that said, please let us work. Newsom got so pissed off because of some of the signage he saw that was excoriating his tactics. He ran a damned riot line. He took his chippies, his CHP crowd, put them in a goon squad outfit. 700 officers running a riot line against two-year-olds and World War II veterans. 32 or 4 people were arrested that day. Tara, Renette, and I are good friends with Tara, Freedom Angels. But I was on my boat. I'm like, you want to arrest me? You're going to work your ass off. You're going to do a pull-up in your little billy club and your little face shield. It's going to be really hard to get me. We all have our lanes. They know what they're good at. I know what I'm good at. So before the SHIT hit the fan, I stood on my boat and I said, it is perfectly lawful in a constitutional republic to open your counties back up regardless of what Newsom says. I was speaking to the counties. By the time we rolled back down the 5 freeway at the end of the weekend, we had somewhere between 5 and 8 counties who were like, yeah, all right, we're going to reopen. Newsom gets wind of it, and he's like, not so quick, Scooter. If you reopen without my blessing, I'm going to withhold all state funding from your state next year. How's that for apples? So all of the counties are like, oh, we kind of need the money. I don't know. And I'm like, yeah, two can play this game. I vaguely recalled hearing Attorney General Bill Barr and Trump say they were going to jawbone that. They were going to jawbone any out-of-line governors who let the power trip go to their head. So I got home after that rigmarole. I sat down at my computer and I typed a little love letter to Trump and Barr. And I said, hey, you don't know who I am. I'm just a little attorney out in California. But this is what our gruesome Newsom governor is up to. And I, you know, detailed his blackmail-y type threat to the counties. And I said, our request is super simple. We simply ask that if Newsom makes good on that threat and withholds all state funding from the counties that reopen, that you respond in kind and withhold all federal funding from our state for 1 year. If you didn't know this, living in Cali, 55% of our budget, give or take, comes from the feds every year. Sincerely, Leigh Dundas, but this was like spring of 2020. Nobody knew who the hell I was. Now I know Eric Trump. Now I know Flynn. I didn't know any of them back then. So I'm like, okay, I need to get somebody besides me to sign the letter. So I had a 3-star admiral who formerly commanded the U.S. Naval Pacific Fleet sign it. I had a guy named Irvine sign it. I had every rich and powerful person. I sent one to Elon. I'm like, please sign my letter. And on Monday morning at 7 a.m., I managed to get this sucker delivered to Trump and Attorney General Bill Barr, which is a whole separate story I don't have time to go into. And it wasn't more than about 8 hours later that Newsom stood in front of a bank of mainstream media reporters in front of his podium and announced that Just kidding. We were going to abandon the new red light, green light lockdown program he had just announced on Friday night. And we were going to be reopened for Dodgers games at least a little bit this summer. And all the reporters were standing there going, wait, okay, we know it's Newsom, but like, what the hell just happened? He did a complete 180. It hasn't even been one business day. And I'm like, yeah, I'm the hell that happened. The unseen hand behind the puppet. So again, you find a bigger bully that is aligned with your cause to beat your little bully on the head, figuratively speaking, until they, you know, do what they should have done in the first place. Last time I did this was a year ago. The Special Olympics had decided it was time to reopen, you know, without masks, let the little disabled kids run their races. And they sent a letter and an application out to all the disabled people families that said you don't need your COVID vaccine. It doesn't matter your COVID vax status, your kid can come play. They were going to hold the games in Orlando, Florida. And so all these families got very excited, and they had their little autistic kids training for an entire year. And a couple of weeks before the games, the Special Olympics decided, just kidding, now you need the COVID vax. So a dad down in South OC alerted me to this, and he goes, I'm sure you don't have time to help, but blah, blah, blah. And I said, you're right, I don't, but I'm going to, because that pissed me off. And so I wrote a letter. Feel free to write your own letter. Her name is Angela Ciccolo. She's the lawyer for the Special Olympics. And I wrote her a letter, and I said, what the hell are you playing at? Your 501c3 exists to elevate the rights and successes of little disabled children that you are currently persecuting. What the hell are you doing? Sit down, shut up, start abiding by federal and state disability and discrimination laws, and get back in your right lane. I was very nice. I didn't quite say it like that, but almost. And normally, I mean, Chapman University, I did this letter a million times if I did it once the last 4 years. There was a doctor who called me. He's like, you saved my medical license. Did not remember helping him. He's like, you helped me with a letter. I'm like, I did? You sure it was me? It wasn't Tom Reds? Oh, yeah, no, I got the email. I'm like, there's so many of these letters. I just did, like, every time I was on an airplane. So I sent the letter off. She retaliates. This woman's a whole new kind of stupid. She didn't just drop it and back off like most of the people did when they got one of my letters. She retaliates by knocking the entire SoCal team out of the U.S. Special Olympics. So the dad calls me. I'm up in Oregon at a Clay Clark event after talking to Trump. He's like, so that kind of backfired. What now? And I'm like, so this is Tucker's phone number. You know Tucker, right? You're going to call Tucker Carlson and these 99 other podcasters, Charlie Ward, Mel Kay, Ann Vandersteel, and you're going to do a name and shame and fry their ass in the court of public opinion, and you're going to give me a minute. And then I picked up my phone and I called Bobby, and I said, hey, Kennedy, you got DeSantis' phone number on you? And he's like, no, Leigh, I'm out and about, but I got Latipo's. I'm like, give it. And he did. I called Latipo, who I did not know. He's the Surgeon General. Awesome. You guys know. I called Latipo, and he's like, do you say your name with one syllable? And I'm like, indeed I do. He goes, I know you. I've seen your viral videos. I'm like, and I know you, because you do such amazing work. So we had a little love fest. And this is actually part of the recipe. I'm not just saying this. You're going to cold call a freaking governor you don't know or a Surgeon General? Spend time having a love fest for 3 minutes. Build some rapport. They'll be much more amenable to whatever big favor you're about to ask. So then I told him what was happening with Special Olympics. He's like, they're doing what? I'm like, too true. He's like, well, what would you do if you were us? Well, bless your heart, I am not Governor DeSantis for a day, but if I were, I would simply tell the Special Olympics Committee, you don't want to abide by state and federal disability law, you get the hell out of my state and play ball somewhere else. And he goes, I like the way you think. Give us a minute. 2 weeks. I finally got to go take Latipo to lunch in October. He goes, you want to hear the rest of the story? I'm like, yeah. He goes, we went back and forth with this woman and Bobby Kennedy's cousin, who was in the Special Olympics Committee, for weeks trying to talk reason into him. And apparently, I told you this woman was a whole new breed of stupid. She just continued to give him the double bird. And this was DeSantis. So a day and a half before the Olympics is supposed to start on Thursday afternoon at noon, it's supposed to start Saturday in Orlando, they hit the Special Olympics Committee with a $27.5 million fine. And that general counsel in Chicago walked that whole requirement of COVID vax back so fast it made your head turn. And then they held a presser.
Just days before the start of the Special Olympics, the organization drops its COVID vaccine mandate. The State Department of Health sent a letter to the organization arguing the requirement that athletes show proof of vaccination violated state law. And now all athletes, vaccinated or not, are allowed to compete in the games.
You know, in Florida, we want all of them to be able to compete. We do not think it's fair or just to be marginalizing some of these athletes based on a decision that has no bearing on their ability to compete.
Yeah. Hello. The voice of reason. Gotta love the voice of reason. So that is how you bully your bully. You find a bigger bully to knock your little bully on the head until they do the right thing. You can do it too. It wasn't like Latipo knew my name before I called. I mean, it turned out he did, but, you know, he would have taken the call. He's a nice guy, if any of you had called too. Power of the People United campaigns is the third thing that y'all need to know how to do. First time I saw this done was 2014. You know, I was down in the brothel town doing a documentary, and I got back to my safe zone, the town of Bangkok, where bombs don't go off every day. I walk out of my hotel to this. There's military in the streets. There's a gajillion people in the streets. Here's a picture of where the military, those are the green hats in the middle, are surrounded by the people, and they're having a coup d'etat. Thailand has a coup d'etat every 5 to 7 years for the last 100. You know why? Because they've lost the ability to have an honest election. Side note, you don't want to be doing this? We need to get right side up on Dominion before the next election. Okay, so there you have it. And when you tell me you had a good showing at the school board, I'm going to ask you if it looked like this. And if it didn't, you got a little ways to go. But keep it up. We'll get there eventually. So there I am. And you see average Thai people fighting tanks and automatic weapons. I don't think they have the right to have their own weapons. Another thing we can't let go of here, our Second Amendment. With their man purse and their bare hands. Okay? This is what it actually looks like to fight for freedom. And if you don't want to be ripping your nail beds out against tank metal, you need to treat every damn day as if this is at your door, because it is. There are two roles in this fight. You are the guy jumping in front of the tank. You want to be a Leigh Dundas, you want to be a whatever Bobby, or you fund it. With your time or your money. Those are the only two roles. If you're not doing one of those, you are selling your children down a river, and it's not a river that ends well. It will be fatal. So there we are, and there's this coup, and the military makes some progress, and then the people make some progress, and it goes on and on, like back and forth for weeks and weeks and weeks. Just total stalemate. Until the Thai farmers decide they've had enough. They get in their big old farm equipment, their tractors, their backhoes, their earth movers, and they start humping and jumping across the Thai countryside, going 13 whopping miles an hour. It takes them a day or two, but they eventually get to Bangkok, and they promptly encircle Bangkok International Airport. And they brought that country to its frickin' knees on a dime. And I watched that happen, and I was like, wow, I think there's a lesson here, and I should remember this. And then I'm like, I live in a first world country. I'm never going to do a convoy. But, you know, life had other plans for me. So for years, in 2019, when we were fighting the bad vaccine bill and we were making not very much progress in Sacramento, I'm like, we need to get the Central California farmers on their threshers and their farm equipment and take it to the Capitol and encircle this Capitol and park some right in front of Newsom's driveway. And people are like, what are you smoking? Timing is everything. Fast forward to 2021, Canada's itching to do a convoy. Had some conversations with those boys. They'd heard Leigh Dundas had been trying to do one in first world countries for 10 years. Had some interesting conversations. It was very successful. And then the American truckers decided they want to do a convoy. Remember that? You know why? We were still locked down. It seems like a distant memory. But in January of 22, all of the blue states were still locked down. So we decided to do a convoy. I go door to door in Adelanto and Barstow looking for a place to hold a launch party, because you can't just have a convoy start out of nowhere. You got to corral them, you know? And I'm knocking on doors in a freaking hailstorm. My bangs are standing up. My new car door is ripping off its hinges. I'm like, hey, looks like you have a whole lot of hard-packed dirt and some asphalt here that's not really used. Any chance we could sublease your space here at the junkyard to host a launch party for a convoy? People are like, 2 days, I went door to door. Not something I learned when I got into Yale Law School. Something I learned selling Girl Scout cookies in second grade. My mom said, you want the like first place prize? You get your butt out there and sell somewhere. You're not there yet. Okay? Knock, 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 bam, bam. No, 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 a million times no. Finally, I hit Adelanto Stadium. Adelanto is the land of endless possibilities, allegedly. Atalanta Stadium is owned by some Samoan-type freedom fighters, some Pacific Islanders. They're like, oh, yeah, we love the whole idea of a convoy. You can do it here. I'm like, great. And so we did. I got them their locations all the way from there, almost all the way to the other seaboard, which is not easy. We had a bajillion people show up. We raised them 30 grand cash, passing the plate that day, put it in the boys' tanks. I got them a law firm, accounting firm to handle their donations so they didn't go sideways on us. Web designers, venues I already talked about, tour buses, because the truckers didn't want to drive their trucks. They actually wanted to be a tour bus, the command center guys. 24/7 news coverage, a Navy SEAL team that a billionaire donated to me because he didn't want me to die. And he didn't want it to be false flag. The last thing we needed was a truck in Iowa joining us. It had a fertilizer bomb in the back that detonates and kills a 5-mile blast zone. And now we're false flagged, even though we were trying to do good. So there you have it. And by the time we reached the Oklahoma border, law enforcement was reporting we were over 7,000 vehicles long and stretching more than 30 miles. Within 1 hour of announcing the convoy, Biden picked up the phone to Sisolak, and then Newsom, and then Whitmer, and all of them. And he said, boys and girl, you are going to open your states. Because when I take the microphone at the State of the Union, first week of March, I want to make this convoy look moot. Last thing I want is an Occupy Ottawa on my side of the border. And so it happened, and we did the convoy, right? If you go back, all of the blue states opened up within 1 week. That's why. We have moles in the White House. So anyway, and people are like, Leigh, why'd you do a convoy? It's a moot issue. I'm like, yeah, but it wouldn't have been if we hadn't have done it. Right? So second time we did this was the vaccine passports. We were the first county hit with the vax passports. I said, what the hell are you playing at? This is Warsaw Ghetto 2.0. We're not doing it.
Leigh Dundas, human rights attorney. Let me be nothing if not clear. You can call this anything you want. A vaccination verification system, a composite app, ink contract for $3.8 million buried in item 28. We all know it when we see it. It is a digital vaccine passport. And there's a reason Clayton Chow shied away from it on camera the other night and said people think it's controversial. Yes, it's controversial. It is the beginning and the end of Nazi Germany. It is show me your papers, please, before you pass. It is an electronic dog collar. And since when did Orange County become the People's Republic of China? You won't need Warsaw ghettos. I won't be able to leave my house because nobody will service me. Are you really okay with big tech knowing every place you've been, from Chipotle to the post office to Disneyland, because you had to scan it every single time you left your house? And do not for a second try to absolve yourselves saying, oh, the marketplace is going to do it. It's on Costco. It's on Disneyland. We're not doing it. That's like the guy who drove the cattle car to Auschwitz saying, there's no blood on my hands. Unlike you all call it what it is. This is a Nazi plan, and you are the Fourth Reich if you vote for it.
Thank you, but I failed. And all Republican board voted for it. You know why? We had so much Soros money in our county pushing that. It was not a joke. They wanted to lock us down. And here's why I gave everything I had to this one move, which I'll tell you about in a second. When you let them restrict your ability to freely travel in any city, country, or nation you are in, you are a walking dead man. When they can restrict your travel, and if you don't have the right paperwork because you're a Jew or you're unvaccinated or you're whatever, all of a sudden they can herd you into an area. Call it a concentration camp, call it a quarantine camp, call it a FEMA camp, doesn't really matter, and then you're dead. I fought like mother frickin' hell on this. So that my reward for that is the board called up the LA Times, who called the Anti-Defamation League that exists to protect the rights of people who were persecuted by Hitler, and I have a great-grandma Romani, gypsy. We had our own Holocaust. Doesn't matter. And they called me a Nazi for calling them the Fourth Reich. That was my reward, was an assassination piece in the LA Times. And I thought, really? The ADL wants to call a granddaughter of a Romani a Nazi? Because I called him out? Well, two can play this game. I'm going to get me an actual Holocaust survivor. It took me 2 weeks. Again, this is nothing I learned in law school. 2 weeks of chasing Vera Shirov's phone number. Finally, somebody gave it to me. Holocaust survivor who spent age 3 to 8 in a concentration camp in New York City. Cold called her. You don't know who I am. I'm a lawyer. It doesn't matter what my name is. But I have a question for you. What think you about these vaccine passports that Orange County and New York City are flirting with right now? There was about a 2-second pause. And she goes, yeah, that. That is a Nazi plan. That is how Hitler started hunting me and my people down. And I said, I don't disagree. Can you give me that in a 30-second soundbite? And I will have my husband, who's a doctor, pretend to be Del Bigtree, because he's got good AV skills, and make a TV commercial and raise $250,000 that I don't have in a Hail Mary trying to get this TV ad that we make with you on the airwaves in the hopes of staying out of Warsaw Ghetto and a whole nother like worldwide genocide. She's like, not a problem. Call me back at 6 a.m. your time tomorrow. Had a little Zoom call. I gave her a script. She threw it out, wrote her own. She's pushing 90. I'm like, OMG. Like, she's almost 90. Does she understand that 30 seconds, not 29 and a half, not 31, exactly 30 seconds is 4.5 sentences? Oh, my God. She's like, I wrote my own script. Yours was okay, but I think mine's better. I'm like, yeah, absolutely. Shoot. And she did, and she gave me 3-letter perfect passes with no false starts and no verbal crutches. This woman's sharper than you and me combined. And then she said, God be with you. Hope it works. I've got a charity gala to go to. And she signed off. And I went running downstairs to my husband. And I'm like, you need to turn this into a TV commercial. He's like, you know I'm not Del Bigtree. I'm like, I know. Just one more time. Because we made some during the vaccine fight in 2019. Every time he almost divorces me. But thank God he hasn't yet. And then I go back upstairs and I call my marketer girl from our old stem cell company who used to place ads for us. I'm like, I need to know what CNN and Fox and MSNBC are going to charge to run this Holocaust survivor ad every single hour on the hour from 4 p.m. to midnight and name and shame our board into dropping the vaccine passport so that we're not in a Warsaw Ghetto worldwide in like 3 weeks. And she's like, yeah, no problem. So she calls and she calls me back and she's like, $250,000. And I'm like, oh, that's bad, but we could probably do it. And she goes, that's not the bad news. And I'm like, what? That's not the bad news? What's the bad news? She goes, no, no, no. They need a credit card right now to hold it or you lose the spot. I am not Simone Gold. I intentionally did not fundraise. I intentionally did not put a group together to fight for freedom because that presupposes we have to keep fighting for freedom. And why would I do that? So I started saying 3728113, first few numbers of my Amex card. I went back downstairs, told my husband what I'd done. He looked at me, he said, are you high? We haven't worked in 13 months. Last paycheck from our stem cell company was March of 2020 because you're like a drowning woman and you keep dragging me off work and we're both going under and we're living off our savings and there's nothing left. How are you going to pay the bill in 2 weeks? You think Orange County's going to back your play? I'm like, damn right I do. I'm stepping out of the boat in faith and here's the thing, babe. If they don't backfill my coffers, it won't freaking matter. We'll be in a FEMA camp by Christmas. It won't matter what my FICO score is. And he goes, game on. And I'm like, God, I love my husband. A chiropractor who can pretend to be Del Bigtree whenever I ask him. And we ran this bad boy every single hour for a week and a half. Oops.
I'm a child survivor of the Holocaust. One of the discriminatory actions against Jews was special passports to identify, discriminate, and persecute us. I shudder to think that places like Orange County, California, are considering special digital vaccine passports. If enacted, those passports will create a two-tier society and deny citizens equal access. Those who disregard history's lesson are doomed to repeat it.
So on the bottom, not bad for a lawyer and a doctor. You can buy Adobe and you can make a TV commercial. Nobody taught my husband and I how to do this. We just did it. You can do it too. Hold a fundraiser, put it on the air. They'll take your money. So we ran a banner that said, if you're on my side of the Mississippi, get your buns to the Orange County board meeting. I don't care what county or state you live in. We had people there from Idaho. We had people there from Texas, Arizona. We had over 2,000 people. It looked like this. It looked like Thailand during a coup when I got out of my car at 6 a.m. Board meeting's not till 9:30. And I said, here's the deal. We are going to stay here all damn day and all damn night. I used to be counsel for the city of West Covina. I know how these board meetings roll. The thing they most fear is not being able to go home. We don't leave until it's done. It didn't take all night. 2:30 afternoon, they came out and they said, we can no longer afford this kind of disruption to democracy. I'm like, baby, you're looking at democracy. This ain't a disruption. This is democracy. Call it what you will. We got it done. And then Newsom said, okay, since Orange County couldn't do it, I'm going to weaponize my little buddies up here, Pan and Wiener and all the rest, and we're going to do it statewide. I reworked that TV ad instead of it was a quick shot of the Auschwitz ghetto, but then I had all their phone numbers up here. I called up my friends in NorCal. I said, you bluff it. You show their kids go to school with Newsoms. I said, you show Jennifer and Gavin this, and you make damn sure that they know that I'll raise the $2 or $3 million it takes to run this from the Oregon border down to Tijuana, and that boy won't survive his recall election, let alone ever see the inside of the White House. 48 hours later, they pulled it. The unseen hand. So you're welcome. You're welcome. But I'm telling you this so that y'all can do it with me. Okay, last time I did this was fall of 21, Power of the People United move. Nothing wins against the power of a people united. Nothing wins against the power of a people united. We can do this. So I get a call from some transport workers. Can everybody stop recording for a sec? I get a call from some transport workers, and they're like, we're 73% unvaccinated, and they're about to lay us all off. I'm like, really? So how much track do you guys own? They're like, we own everything from Chicago down to New Orleans down to Malibu. It's a duopoly. And the other half of the country is ready to roll too. I said, what happens when you boys walk off the job for a day? They're like, it creates a 30-day backlog on the supply chain. I'm like, really? Well, y'all know you're not allowed to go on strike, right? They're like, yeah. I'm like, yeah, but I heard Fauci saying the flu was going to be real bad come November. In fact, I'm looking at my crystal ball, and it looks like it's going to hit out here November 8th, 9th, 10th, and 11th. And correct me if I'm wrong, but as large equipment operators like pilots, you're not allowed to go to work when you're high on NyQuil, right? Because you could jump a train or crash a plane. And they're like, that's right. I'm like, all right, see you later. So then we built a nationwide walkout around that because that was, you know, there. And we had doctors, we had lawyers, we had judges, we had bailiffs, we had Procter & Gamble workers. If you don't know what Procter & Gamble makes, everything that is not edible in your house is made by Procter & Gamble, from your diapers to your razors to your toothpaste to your laundry detergent. We had trash. You want to bring a first world country to its knees? Remember this. Get the trash collectors to walk off the job. We had nuclear. We have 6 nuclear plants. They walked off. You never heard about it. Mainstream media didn't cover it. But millions of people coast to coast walked off during that week. It was a checkmate move. General Flynn was in. Lynn Wood was in. Simone Gold, Bobby Kennedy, Tom Rhodes. When was the last time you heard all of these people playing nice together? Never. We all understood it for what it was. A checkmate move. And within an hour of announcing that, people knew that it was a problem. The White House was rolling back. Oh, it's a soft mandate, not a hard cliff here. And then I was making damn sure I back-channeled it to the federal court judges. And I was like, I get that you have not yet ruled against a Biden vaccine mandate, not in any sector. You keep kissing these cases off. You keep dismissing them on a technicality. But understand this. If Biden wants to get in a pissing match in a chicken game with the blue-collar boys with the big old toys, he's going to lose. And your wife's not going to have toilet paper before the end of the year. So you want to keep going, oh, we're not going to get in the game. That's fine. But understand the score. So on Friday night at midnight, we got our first ruling out of the Federal Court of Appeals in the Southern District against Biden's vaccine mandate. This is what it looked like.
They say, all my wolves begin to
howl, wake me up, the time is now. Live over an anti-vaccine mandate protest.
You don't have freedom if you have the government mandating a jab and making your job contingent on it.
Everybody who is anybody is supporting this, from Bobby Kennedy to Simone Gold to General Flynn.
Government has signed deals to buy 2 more experimental coronavirus vaccines, but it's still unclear whether any of them will actually work.
We have been waiting for a checkmate move.
The light of liberty and the light of freedom is too valuable to ever go out on our watch. God bless America!
Yay! Within 48 hours last week of this little flyer being posted everywhere, guess what Biden did? He walked it back.
The people who were here today were here for a single solitary reason, and that was to fight for freedom.
I've been waiting all my life to live when I've only been dreaming, get love when I've only been stealing.
You're gonna need some gentle people around.
Hold the line, my body, my choice, and that's where I draw the line.
Hold the line, hold the line, bleed that, hold the line. You the only thing standing between them and I.
Hold the line, hold the line. You a sheep or you a lion? Better get it out your mind. You ain't touching none of mine.
This is a war on religion. This is a war on the children. They give you the cure with the sickness. This is a war on tradition. This is a war on religion. This is a war on the children. They give you the cure with the sickness. This is a war. This is a war.
You did good. Y'all.
all did good this week, and don't stop, because that Fifth Circuit Court of Appeals ruling was on the heels of the people making known that tyranny would no longer be allowed in this country, or indeed the world, by forcing unwilling employees to take their shots, take their tests, or hit the darned road. The administration poured over the U.S. code in search of authority or a workaround. This mandate is a one-size-fits-all sledgehammer. It substantially burdens liberty interests by giving these workers a choice between their jobs or a jab. They said, from economic uncertainty to workplace strife, the mere specter of the mandate has contributed to untold economic upheaval in recent months.
We are Procter & Gamble.
You don't know our names.
You don't know our faces.
But there are thousands of us.
And we work to produce the brands and products you use every single day.
You may not care about us being attacked.
You may not even care if we're terminated.
But know this.
You'll start to care when our termination begins to affect you personally.
OSHA is ordered to take no steps to implement or try to enforce this mandate. Started was a match that lit a fire around the world. Bobby Kennedy is in Europe right now. We've got Maori in New Zealand rising up this morning. We will not take this. We will not take this. This is a violation of the Nuremberg Code. This is a violation of black letter federal law. And this is an atrocity against our children. And you will stand trial for crimes against humanity if you continue.
Religion. This is a war on the children. They give you the cure with the sickness. This is a war on tradition. This is a war on religion. This is a war on the children. They give you the cure with the sickness.
Thank you, guys. I'm going to wrap up with a couple more words. I've got 2.5 minutes, I think, because we started 2 minutes late. This is a war. This is a war. You don't have time to be funding your Army and Navy grunts. An Army and Navy grunt has a 20-to-1 kill ratio, meaning for every 20 enemy combatants they take out, we lose one. You want to know what a Navy SEAL sniper or Special Forces sniper's kill ratio is? 400-to-1. We need to be running the plays that work. We need to be putting the plays that work in the hands of the people. And lawsuits and legislation are not that. And when you hear a nonprofit say, we've had a great success, we filed this case and they backed off, well, guess what? That's not a win in court. You scared them into backing off, and you could have done any one of these things that cost $20 instead of $20,000 or $200,000 and get her done. I love the lawsuits and legislation, but I don't like changing my tire with a spoon. Got it? Okay. So, shameless plug, you want to see Leigh Dundas continue to be in the fight and get this out to the population? Hold me a fundraiser or donate, okay? These are my assistants. I love them, but they sleep a lot and they don't have opposable thumbs. I definitely need to upgrade here. This is where you can donate. You scan the QR code. I'm not techie like that. I don't know how to do it. I think everybody should be giving $10. It doesn't need to be to me. If it's some other freedom fighter out there and you run their statistics and they're getting a win, go for it. But if it is me, thank you. And by the way, if you don't have $10, you shouldn't be here. And by the way, you might want to consider what you spend on your children's Christmas budget and matching that in a dono today. Because I'd like to think that your child's freedom is at least worth the cost of their Xbox. Now, I'm going to tell you how we win, because make no damn mistake, we are going to win this war. Best story I have ever heard about a winner doesn't involve a person, it involves a horse. There was a horse named Secretariat. who was born in 1970. Big red stallion. He had a girth that was huge. They had custom cinches, the leather strap around the belly because it was so big. His heart was 3 times bigger than average when they autopsied it at the end of his life. And when that boy was flying down the track at full extension, he had a 24-foot span. His signature move was letting all the other ponies get way down the field, and in the last few seconds of the race, he'd be like, yeah, I'm going to drop it into overdrive, and that boy would start churning and pounding down that track and come from behind and blow past all the other ponies and break the wire for first place. That was his move. That is what he was known for. So in 1972 or 3, when I was barely born, he had already won the first 2 races of the Triple Crown. Third race was a very long race. It's called the Belmont Stakes. It's a 1.5-mile track on dirt. Longest race we run here in America. And game day comes. Everybody thought, by the way, all the experts, that it was going to be a match race, a runoff between the top 2 contenders. Screw the other guys on the field. It was down to Sham and Secretariat. They were the top 2 contenders. Race day comes, the bell goes off, the chutes open up, and those 2 horses come out of there hot. Secretariat lays down a world record-breaking pace for the first quarter-mile length of that race. And at that point in time, you hear Penny Chenery turn to her manager, she was the owner of Secretariat, in the stands and go, there's no way we're winning this. My horse comes from behind. He doesn't lead from in front. And even if he did, this is a 1.5-mile race, and he is running that way too fast at the start. But win the race and run the race at that rate, he did, because he laid down that first quarter-mile length at a world record pace, and then he did the same thing on the second leg of the race and the third race. It was 25 seconds, then it was 24 3/5, 24 2/5, 23 3/5, 23 seconds flat. That horse did the mother-frickin' impossible. He ran every single quarter mile faster than the one before, and he was still accelerating as he broke the damn wire. And when you get to the final, when you get to the final shot, he's coming into the last corner, and now they have to back so far up, his wide-angle lens, because they can't keep all the horses in the shot anymore. So Sham and Secretariat, all the rest are way behind, and you hear Chick Anderson cue up in his mic, and he goes, oh my God, Secretariat is starting to make his move. He is out in front. He is blazing down the track. He is widening the gap in the final turn. He is moving like a tremendous machine. And that horse broke the wire with the fastest time ever laid down on dirt. A 31-length lead between him and the next nearest horse, an 1/8 mile. In a record that still stands now, 50 years later. I am not asking you to back me in my nonprofit because I'm good on a mic, or a nice lawyer, or because you liked my corgi. I'm asking you to consider donating and holding me a fundraiser. Because just like that horse was born for a reason, all of us were born for a singular reason. We were put here on this planet for a reason. And just like that horse was born to run and win the races he did, I believe I was born to run and win the race that we are in. And my promise to you is if we all bind together and support each other, that we will win this race and leave the devil so damn far behind he never catches us or our kids. That is my promise. That is my prayer. God bless you guys. I'll see you out there for my book. And I don't know if you're so inclined. Give yourselves a round of applause. You were amazing. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Appreciate you. Thanks for coming out on Super Bowl Sunday to do something that wasn't football. I'll tell my husband that.